Emerson and Thoreau by Sanderson Beck. Channing on War. Let us teach that the honor of a nation consists not in the forced submission of other states, but in equal laws and free institutions, in cultivated fields and prosperous cities, in the development of intellectual and moral power, in the diffusion of knowledge, in magnanimity and justice, in the virtues and blessings of peace. William Ellery Channing, First Discourse on War. William Ellery Channing, 1780-1842, was a forerunner of the Transcendentalists and preached against slavery, poverty, and war at a Boston church from 1803 until his death. He began as a Congregationalist, but in 1815 he was attacked as a Unitarian. He defended Unitarian Christianity and in 1820 formed a conference of liberal congregational ministers, which 5 years later became the American Unitarian Association. Channing, like Emerson, disliked sectarian squabbles, and Emerson praised him above all other ministers. Channing was active in the peace movement, which began in 1815 when Noah Worster founded the Massachusetts Peace Society, the first influential peace society in the world. Channing's first address on war was given to the Congregational Ministers of Massachusetts at Boston in 1816. He described the miseries and crimes of war, their causes, and some possible remedies. In addition to the suffering and destruction, he pointed out how war corrupts the morals of society, promotes criminal modes of subsistence, and endows government with dangerous powers. The sources of war are the human propensity for excitement that makes war the deepest game of all, the passion for superiority and power, admiration for warlike deeds, false patriotism that puts one's nation above others, and upbringing and education which glamorize military exploits. Channing saw the remedies as well as the causes to be of a moral nature, yet he considered national subjugation worse than a war of defense. He argued that just as a government has a right to repress the violence of its own citizens, it also may resist the foreign army because the very end and office of government is to resist evil men. He suggested that rulers should take more honor in the prosperity of their states than in the extent of their territories. Even more, we should honor nations for their free institutions, equal laws, knowledge, benevolence, and justice. We must learn to admire the heroes of conscience, human rights, the martyrs for peace and freedom more than the false attributes of military courage. The peaceful qualities of the Christian teachings ought to be emphasized and demonstrated by its ministers. Courage can reach a much more generous height working for peace than on the rough field of war. Channing gave another discourse on war on January 25, 1835. He suggested that the most conspicuous use of human wisdom has been to use civil institutions to repress war, retaliation, and resort to force among citizens of the same state. But governments have organized and let loose their forces against other nations, spreading desolation, misery, and death. All other evils fade in comparison to war. The old barbarous worship of mere courage must be replaced by wise moral judgment. Justice must be the first element of a nation's honor. People who systematically sacrifice justice for their own selfish interests are basically a band of robbers. The next element of national honor that Channing recommended is the spirit of philanthropy. Spreading education can purify morals and refine manners. Once again, Channing disagreed with the non-resistance, as he believed that outrages against peace must be repressed by force. Yet a nation should engage in war wisely, aware of what is right and with sorrow. Usually, a nation loses more by going to war to redress a past wrong. The main consideration should be security for the future. He held that governments have a duty to protect their people from violence and aggression. To make sure that it is being just, a nation should refer disputes to an impartial umpire. An unjust war involves people in the guilt of murder. Channing also gave a lecture on war in 1838. Again, he described the physical and moral evils of war, which can only be overcome by the principles of universal justice and love. He noted that Europe had been at peace since 1816 and had been able to apply its industry to useful arts. He emphasized the inward morality. No calculations of interest, no schemes of policy can do the work of love, of the spirit of human brotherhood. There can be no peace without, but through peace within. Channing found various reasons why people become insensitive to war. First, it appears common and seems familiar. Second, war is exercised by the great power of the government with its assumption that it is right. Yet, he argued that government's right to war must be bounded, and those who go beyond what is truly right are responsible. Thus, he maintained that the citizen, before fighting, must inquire into the justice of the cause and is bound to withhold his hand if his conscience condemns the cause. The presumption should be that war is always unjust because of the dangers of false patriotism. Channing warned that the attitude of rulers and nations towards foreign states, which is usually partial and unjust, ought to show us that war is rarely just or necessary. He advised the Christian to refuse war and to submit, if necessary, to prison and execution in martyrdom for peace. We must distinguish between reasonable laws and those which require a person to commit manifest crimes. Every individual is responsible for one's own actions, even if the rulers claim the right of war. In a republican government, the rights of speech, press, and peaceful methods of redressing public grievances are extremely valuable. Even in war, these freedoms are of great importance. Channing tempered the right of free discussion with the admonition to speak and write only the truth. The third cause of insensitivity he attributed to the deceptive shows, costumes, and splendor by which war is arrayed. Finally, he noted that people tend to be blind to the dignity of human nature because they do not see their enemies and dehumanize them. Channing also drew lessons from the life of Napoleon and exposed the problems caused by the passion for dominion. On August 1, 1837, Channing published an 80-page open letter to Henry Clay on the annexation of Texas. He reviewed the insurrection and the underlying scheme to take over Mexican territory and considered it the first encroaching step toward crime, war, and the extension of slavery. Although he did not want to see the Union dissolved, he indicated he would prefer that to becoming a partner in this war to spread slavery. After the death of Noah Worcester in November 1837, Channing wrote a tribute to the saintly founder of the Massachusetts Peace Society. At the end of his life, Channing wrote that if the spirit of justice and humanity pervaded the country, they would not be easily driven to war. Emerson's Transcendentalism. Love is the adamantine shield which makes blows ridiculous. Ralph Waldo Emerson, Journals 3, 295. The manhood that has been in war must be transferred to the cause of peace before war can lose its charm and peace be venerable to men. Ralph Waldo Emerson, War. Whenever we see the doctrine of peace embraced by a nation, we may be assured it will not be one that invites injury, but one, on the contrary, which has a friend in the bottom of the heart of every man, even of the violent and the base. One against which no weapon can prosper. One which is looked upon as the asylum of the human race and has the tears and the blessings of mankind. Ralph Waldo Emerson, War. Ralph Waldo Emerson was born on May 25, 1803, in Boston, Massachusetts, as the son of a Unitarian minister. He graduated from Harvard College in 1821. Emerson married in 1829, but his wife died less than a year and a half later. At this point, he doubted his beliefs and profession as a minister, and he decided to resign, stating that it was because of the Eucharist. In 1832, he went to Europe, where he met such noteworthies as Wordsworth, Coleridge, and Carlyle. Emerson gave public lectures, and in 1836, he published Nature. He had become the Sage of Concord, and the literary colleagues gathering around him became known as the Transcendental Club. Emerson's inspiring lectures, essays, and poems elucidated a philosophy of life based on the inner resources of the self and revelation from the divine presence of the soul. Trust yourself, he would say, and live spontaneously and freely in harmony with nature. He described the spiritual laws of life in great essays such as Compensation, Spiritual Laws, Love, Self-Reliance, and The Oversoul. He found his own insights echoed in the Hindu scriptures and the Romantic poets. He urged an American renaissance of culture and influenced writers such as Thoreau, Whitman, Hawthorne, and the Alcott family. He believed that culture was a way of modulating violence, which is not power, but the absence of power. He concluded Self-Reliance with these words: "Nothing can bring you peace but yourself. Nothing can bring you peace but the triumph of principles." In 1832, Emerson heard the very good views of Channing at a peace meeting. Emerson criticized the Mexican War, which he felt was caused chiefly by the interests of the slave states, and he prophesied that there would be retribution for the nation, just as there is for any private felon. In a discussion with Thomas Carlyle at Stonehenge a few years later, Emerson put forward the pacifist philosophy of non-resistance and non-cooperation with governments which institutionalize violence as an indigenous American conviction. This idea was championed by the abolitionist William Lloyd Garrison and others who would not compromise on this point as Channing had. Emerson gave one or two anecdotes which made an impression on Carlyle and concluded, "'Tis certain as God liveth, the gun that does not need another gun, the law of love and justice alone can effect a clean revolution." For Emerson, the soul transcends all conflict and has no enemies. Soldiers he considered to be ridiculous. War is abhorrent to all right reason and against human progress. From the perspective of spiritual oneness, he spoke of the blazing truth that he who kills his brother commits suicide. He looked at the Civil War as a retribution to purge the nation of the evil of slavery, and he detested the lack of freedom during the war. In 1865, he vowed that if martial law came to Concord, he would disobey it or move elsewhere. He foresaw that dream of good men not yet come to pass, an international congress. Prophetic also was this: as if the earth, water, gases, lightning, and caloric had not a million energies, the discovery of any one of which could change the art of war again and put an end to war by the exterminating forces man can apply. In 1838, Emerson delivered an address to the Boston meeting of the American Peace Society, which has been published under the title War, and contains his thinking on the issues of war and peace. He described war as an epidemic insanity, breaking out here and there like the cholera or influenza infecting men's brains instead of their bowels. He could see that violence was dangerously contagious. For Emerson, war is part of wild and primitive societies, and the primitive stages of religion lead to religious wars. It is the ignorant and childish part of mankind that is the fighting part. Cruelty and violence are juvenile, and the mature spirit renounces them. Like others, Emerson noted that trade works against war because it gives people contact, knowledge, and familiarity with their enemies. The development of learning, art, and religion make war seem like fratricide, and he added that it is. History depicts the slow mitigation and decline of war, yet the doctrine of the right of war still remains. Emerson asked the perennial question, cannot we have love instead of hate, peace instead of war? This idea, he pointed out, was not invented by Saint Pierre nor Rousseau, but it is the rising of the general tide in the human soul, and rising highest and first made visible in the most simple and pure souls, who have therefore announced it to us beforehand. But presently we all see it. Societies have been formed on this thought, and the hopes and prayers for peace are preparing for its actualization. Though it appears to be visionary to most, the idea is growing in influence and is inevitable. War is on its last legs, and a universal peace is as sure as is the prevalence of civilization over barbarism, of liberal governments over feudal forms. The question for us is only, how soon? What is good and true will eventually prevail. The wise learn to trust ideas over circumstances, for appearances depend on the mind. Every nation and every man instantly surround themselves with a material apparatus which exactly corresponds to their moral state or their state of thought. Our war establishments only serve as an index to show where man is now, what a bad, ungoverned temper he has, what an ugly neighbor he is, how his affections halt, how low his hope lies. However, friendly attitudes can change all this and make weapons things of the past to be displayed only in museums. Emerson delineated three stages of cultivation in regard to war and peace. At a certain stage of his progress, the man fights, if he be of a sound body and mind. At a certain higher stage, he makes no offensive demonstration, but is alert to repel injury and of an unconquerable heart. At a still higher stage, he comes into the region of holiness. Passion has passed away from him. His warlike nature is all converted into an active medicinal principle. He sacrifices himself and accepts with alacrity wearisome tasks of denial and charity. But being attacked, he bears it and turns the other cheek, as one engaged throughout his being, no longer to the service of an individual, but to the common soul of all men. Emerson answered the common criticism of non-resistance even to the extent of not defending oneself or one's family against robbers and assassins. This, he said, only looks at the passive side of the friend of peace. Lovers of peace obviously do not choose to be plundered or slain. If they accept martyrdom, it is for some active purpose, some equal motive, some flaming love. If you have a nation of men who have risen to that height of moral cultivation that they will not declare war or carry arms, for they have not so much madness left in their brains, you have a nation of lovers, of benefactors, of true, great, and able men. Let me know more of that nation. I shall not find them defenseless, with idle hands swinging at their sides. I shall find them men of love, honor, and truth, men of immense industry, men whose influence is felt to the end of the earth, men whose very look and voice carry the sentence of honor and shame, and all forces yield to their energy and persuasion. A peaceful nation is protected by its spiritual power because everyone is its friend. In individual cases, it is extremely rare that a person of peace ever attracts violence. Yet Emerson added that the wise do not decide in advance how to respond, but they follow the guidance of nature and God. Emerson observed that organizing societies, passing resolutions, and publishing manifestos are not too effective, especially when the participants do not practice what they preach when put to the test. He preferred private conviction to public opinion. Our hope is in increased insight, and it is to be accomplished by the spontaneous teaching of the cultivated soul in its secret experience and meditation. Thus, humans can expel their devils, transmute their bestial nature, hear the voice of God, and go forward in their right minds. Nor is fear the right motive for peace. Nothing great can be attained by cowards. Courage must be transferred from war to the cause of peace. Individuals are responsible for themselves and should not ask for protection from the state. The person of principle cannot be coerced into any wrongdoing and will not compromise one's freedom and integrity. The cause of peace is not for the cowardly preservation of the safety of the luxurious and the timid. Peace must be maintained by true heroes who are willing to stake their lives for their principle and who go beyond the traditional hero in that they will not threaten another person's life. Who have by their intellectual insight or else by their moral elevation attained such a perception of their own intrinsic worth that they do not think property or their own body a sufficient good to be saved by such dereliction of principle as treating a man like a sheep. Emerson placed his faith in the search of the sublime laws of morals and the sources of hope and trust in man and not in books, in the present, and not in the past. And he hoped that these would bring war to an end. The way this happens is of little importance, although he predicted that society and events point toward a Congress of Nations. Once the mind accepts the reign of principles, the modes of expression are easily found. At the end of this excellent essay on war, Emerson asked his readers if it shall be war or peace. After his friend Thoreau went to jail for failing to pay his poll tax, Emerson wrote in his journal that the abolitionists give much time to denouncing the Mexican War, but pay their tax. He suggested they ought to resist and go to prison in multitudes on their known and described disagreements from the state. He also noted that the state tax does not pay for the war, but that imported goods such as coats, sugar, foreign books, and watches do. Later in his life, Emerson proposed boycotting all goods produced by slave labor. In an address in Concord on August 1, 1844, the 10th anniversary of the slaves' emancipation in the British West Indies, he suggested that the United States could follow the British example by buying the freedom of the slaves from their plantation owners. Thoreau's Civil Disobedience. Only the defeated and deserters go to the wars, cowards that run away and enlist. Henry David Thoreau. Men make an arbitrary code, and because it is not right, they try to make it prevail by might. The moral law does not want any champion. Its asserters do not go to war. It was never infringed with impunity. Henry David Thoreau, Civil Disobedience. The law will never make men free. It is men who have got to make the law free. They are the lovers of law and order who observe the law when the government breaks it. Henry David Thoreau, Civil Disobedience. If 1,000 men were not to pay their tax bills this year, that would not be a violent and bloody measure, as it would be to pay them and enable the state to commit violence and shed innocent blood. This is, in fact, the definition of a peaceable revolution, if any such is possible. Henry David Thoreau, Civil Disobedience. Henry David Thoreau was born in Concord, Massachusetts, on July 12, 1817, and died there peacefully on May 6, 1862. He was educated at Harvard, 1833-37, where he developed his love for Greek and Roman poetry, Oriental philosophy, and botany. He earned his living doing odd jobs, teaching school, and making lead pencils. He spent little time working at these, though. Having few wants, he made free time his greatest wealth. He loved nature, and his preoccupation 4 hours each day was exploring the woods and ponds, making detailed observations of plants and creatures. Emerson was his close friend, and he lived in Emerson's house for a time. Henry had a singular life, never marrying, and marching to his own drummer, as he put it. From 1845 to 1847, he lived alone in a small cabin he built by Walden Pond near Concord. He described this unique experiment in natural living in his great book, Walden. Despite all the superfluities of customary society, he believed the mass of men lead lives of quiet desperation. Thoreau lectured occasionally and struggled to get his writings published. His personal independence and straightforward manner was abrasive to some people, and he gained very little recognition during his lifetime. He lectured and wrote against slavery, particularly when the Fugitive Slave Law was passed in 1850, compelling northern law enforcement officials to capture and return runaway slaves. Thoreau was known to have helped some runaways, and he thought it absurd for a court to try to decide whether a person ought to be free. He defended the radical abolitionist John Brown. By his personal example, Thoreau put into practice the transcendentalist principles of self-reliance, personal integrity, and spontaneous intuition. About the uplifting spiritual energy within, he wrote, "I know of no more encouraging fact than the unquestionable ability of man to elevate his life by a conscious endeavor." He stated, "Moral reform is the effort to throw off sleep." For Thoreau, philosophy was not clever logic or formulating a doctrine, but loving wisdom by living according to its dictates in simplicity, independence, magnanimity, and trust. He exhorted people to explore themselves and love life. "We must learn to obey the laws of our own being, which will never be in opposition to a just government." Thoreau's great innovation was in the ways he suggested for opposing an unjust government in order to be true to the higher laws of one's own being. One day in late July of 1846, while he was living at Walden, he walked into Concord to get a shoe repaired. He was met by his friend Sam Staples, who was the local tax collector, constable, and jailer. Thoreau had not paid his tax for several years. Staples offered to pay Henry's tax for him or get it reduced, but Thoreau declared that he did not intend to pay it as a matter of principle. When Staples asked what he should do about it, Thoreau suggested that he resign his office. However, Staples replied, "Henry, if you don't pay, I shall have to lock you up pretty soon." Thoreau answered him, "As well now as any time, Sam." So Staples took him to jail. The tax was paid by someone, probably Thoreau's Aunt Mariah, and Henry was released the next morning. According to Staples, Thoreau was as mad as the devil and did not want to leave jail, but Staples made him. He wanted to stay so he could call attention to the abolitionist cause and the Mexican War. People in Concord wanted to know the reasons for his going to jail, so Thoreau wrote out an explanation and gave it as a lecture twice in 1848. It was published in 1849 as Resistance to Civil Government and posthumously in 1866 as Civil Disobedience. Thoreau began his essay with the well-known motto, "That government is best which governs least." This, he carried to its natural conclusion, is no government at all, which he said will happen when people are prepared. He objected particularly to a standing army and the current Mexican War, the work of comparatively a few individuals using the standing government as their tool. Yet Thoreau realized that the immediate need is not for no government, but for better government. Let every man make known what kind of government would command his respect, and that will be one step toward obtaining it. Majorities usually rule because they are the strongest physically, but their policies are based upon expediency. Thoreau asks whether it is not better to decide right and wrong by conscience, which everyone has. It is not desirable to cultivate a respect for the law so much as for the right. The only obligation which I have a right to assume is to do at any time what I think right. But a corporation has no conscience, although conscientious people may be a corporation with a conscience. Undue respect for law leads to soldiers marching to the wars against their wills, common sense, and consciences. Such men have let themselves become machines, serving the state with their bodies. Others, like lawyers and politicians, serve the state with their heads. A few, reformers and martyrs, serve the state with their consciences also, but they are usually treated as enemies. Thoreau declared that he could not associate with the American government because it was a slave's government. He appealed to the right of revolution in the case of 1775. He lamented, "A sixth of the population of a nation which has undertaken to be the refuge of liberty are slaves. It has become a military state, and honest men ought to rebel." He criticized not only southern slaveholders, but northern merchants and farmers who care more about commerce and agriculture than they do about humanity. Thousands are against slavery in the war, but they do nothing about it. Voting, he said, is like playing a game with right and wrong. Voting for the right does nothing for it if the majority passes the expedient instead. Thoreau accurately predicted that by the time the majority abolished slavery, there would be no slavery left to abolish. Although it is not necessarily a person's duty to work to eradicate a wrong, it is one's duty not to support practically a wrong. We must not only refuse to fight in an unjust war, but also refuse to support the unjust government which conducts the war. Thoreau suggested that individuals refuse to pay their quota into the treasury. Action from principle, the perception and performance of right, changes things and relations. It is essentially revolutionary. When unjust laws exist, there are three choices. One, obey them. Two, obey them while working to change them, or three, transgress them at once. Yet the evil resulting from breaking an unjust law is the fault of the government. Thoreau wondered why government resists reform. Why does it always crucify Christ and excommunicate Copernicus and Luther and pronounce Washington and Franklin rebels? Thoreau advises us to let minor injustices pass if the remedy is worse than the evil. But if it is of such a nature that it requires you to be the agent of injustice to another, then I say break the law. Let your life be a counter-friction to stop the machine. What I have to do is to see, at any rate, that I do not lend myself to the wrong which I condemn. If a person is truly in the right, one has God on one side and constitutes a majority of one. His contact with the tax collector was Thoreau's only association with the government and therefore his best means of protest. The action of one honest man can do more for reform than all the words in the world. Under a government which imprisons any unjustly, the true place for a just man is also a prison. The person who has experienced a little injustice for the sake of justice is more effective, as truth is stronger than error. Thoreau exhorted us, "Cast your whole vote, not a strip of paper merely, but your whole influence. A minority is powerless while it conforms to the majority. It is not even a minority then, but it is irresistible when it clogs by its whole weight. If the alternative is to keep all just men in prison or give up war and slavery, the state will not hesitate which to choose. Thoreau treated of imprisonment instead of the seizure of property because he believed that people of principle are usually poor. The rich have sold themselves to the institution, and they enjoy Caesar's government and neglect God. It is not necessary to rely on the protection of the state. When the state is corrupt, it is no shame to be poor. Thence, disobedience is more worthy than obeying. In prison, Thoreau thought of the absurdity of confining his body when his mind and spirit are free. He pitied the state for trying to punish his body because they could not get at him. They use superior physical strength against his body, but moral force comes from a higher law. When a government says, your money or your life, it is playing the thief. Why should one give in to that? Thoreau described his stay in prison and the changed attitude of the townspeople to him when he came out. He also mentioned that he never refused to pay the highway tax or support the schools, but he must refuse allegiance to the state. Those whose taxes support the state at war are helping injustice. Thoreau expressed an eagerness to conform to the laws of the land so long as there is no moral principle to be violated. He was willing to obey those who know more than he, yet the authority of the government depends on the consent of the governed. There will never be a really free and enlightened state until the state comes to recognize the individual as a higher and independent power, from which all its own power and authority are derived, and treats him accordingly. Thoreau's essay had little impact in the 19th century, but in the 20th it has become a manual for social protest. Leo Tolstoy noticed it and asked Americans why they did not pay more attention to Thoreau's ideas instead of their financial and industrial millionaires and their generals and admirals. Mahatma Gandhi put civil disobedience into practice on a mass scale in South Africa and India. Martin Luther King used the techniques in the civil rights movement, and anti-war activists have also applied these principles, as we shall see in later chapters.